thank you all so much for coming. My name is Tara Pierce. I've been a volunteer organizer for this event, and I've been really impressed by what has happened over the last few months. This conference was the creative vision of a small group of grad students, and they worked many long hours to transform it into the reality of all of us sitting here tonight. And undergrads. We had undergrad help as well. And we also had a lot of support from the rest of the OSU community, for which we are very grateful. And it's wonderful to see so many of you joining us. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce a professor of philosophy, Dr. Robert Figueroa.
Thank you. I don't get to do this very often, and it's really my opportunity to... I think the most difficult thing in the business is actually introducing people who, really should just get on stage and not be introduced, and we should all discover. I've always found this to be the most difficult thing. So I want to thank... I guess I'm speaking as an administrator of philosophy here, which I don't know what that means, yes, but... Barbara Maraca, in particular, came up with this idea and pushed it through. People agreed with her, and by the time we said, okay, we'll do something, she was halfway through it, with the students, graduate students, and undergraduate. Really remarkable. Thank you, Barbara. She will obviously pass on all of the respect to the undergraduate students and the graduate students who have done so much to keep this vision going and to make it, but we all know that Barbara is the sort of spirit that brought this together. And it is a wonderful program. This is really progressive, really appropriate for the moment we're in, and I can't thank you enough for what you're doing. And I'm just an observer, and I that's something I rarely get to do. And so just keep the work up, because really, really wonderful. All of you, it's tremendous. So I have the challenge of introducing someone who just brings me in awe of the kind of activism and scholarship that is necessary at this very moment, and hopefully will inspire everyone in the room to continue your own form of activism at this very moment, and don't let that moment stop. So the first thing, looking through the interweb, I think it's always interesting to go to someone's most recent book to find out what they're up to. So Harsha, Walia is book here is Undoing Border Imperialism, and I think you should we'll do bidding soon, and the highest bidder will get some books. And I think we should really look at this as an opportunity to pick up the press directly from the author, and the price ranges from depending on what you want to pay me for it. I think $30, $40, $90. So we might have some bidding. But looking at the reviews, Naomi Klein, who we all love to talk about, states Harsha Walia has played a central role in building some of North America's most innovative, diverse, and effective new movements. That this brilliant organizer and theorist has found time to share her wisdom in this book is a tremendous gift to us all. And I think that's true. But now, first you have to open the book and find out what it means to be a tremendous gift to us all. So in describing Undoing Border Imperialism, we have the press's description is that the book combines academic discourse, lived experiences of displacement, and movement-based practices into an exciting new book by reformulating immigrant rights movements within a transnational analysis of capitalism, labor exploitation, settler colonialism, state-building, and racialized empire. It provides the alternative conceptual frameworks of border imperialism and decolonization. drawing on the author's experiences in No One Is Illegal, which is one of those things that you can Google and learn about this tremendous grassroots effort of No One Is Illegal. This work offers relevant insights for all social movement organizers on effective strategies to overcome the barriers and borders within movements in order to cultivate fierce, loving, and sustainable communities of resistance striving towards liberation. And I don't have to go on too much further because it's so good that I'll leave it to Harsha to finish up the rest of the story. So join me in introducing and welcoming Harsha Walia. Thank you.
Hi everyone. How are you?
Good.
Good. Thank you for sharing your Friday night with me. That's to my campus setting. I should say, if any point during the presentation you want to heckle or holler, please do. I know we're at Campus University Lecture Theater, but in as much as we can interact through this, it's welcome. So please do whatever you're called to do. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to the organizers for having me. It's an honor to be here. I want to acknowledge a few things to start. First of all, of course, all the work and effort that goes into hosting events. The labor that we see and also the labor that we don't see, right? So the folks that clean up after us, the folks that bring us into these spaces. And, also knowing that the labor that we often don't see is gendered, and that's because patriarchy is structured that way, that we don't see the labor particularly of women and trans folks. So I just want to acknowledge that and honor all of the labor that's gone into hosting me and us here. I also want to acknowledge that the territories that I'm gathered on here today are lands that have always belonged to Indigenous peoples. And so I want to just pay respects to Indigenous peoples whose lands I'm on here today. I live in Vancouver, which is lands of the Coast Salish people, the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Squamish people. So I want to say to anyone here whose territory this is that I come here in a good way, and that I hope that the way that I'm present here on your land is something that contributes to your problems, which is incredible. I also want to say that, you know, of course, you know this better than I do, but we're living in a time of escalated heightened white supremacy and political violence on our bodies. And so for everyone in this room who is, use it, yes. So everyone in this room who is Black, who is Indigenous, who is racialized, who is Muslim, who is of color, and particularly those of us who are queer and trans folks, I just want to say that you are loved, you are brilliant, you are beautiful. And it is your and our collective resilience and strength that has always existed, that has always been what has gotten us through times like Trump and beyond and before, that's going to get us through this. And so I believe in us, I believe in you, and whether you're ready to fight or whether we need time to breathe, whatever it is that we need, I'm here with you. And I hope that what we leave with here today is our collective sense of struggle and solidarity and community. So, you know, one of the signs that I walked by here today on campus was, you know, one that we've, an iteration that we've heard a lot, right? Which is no ban, no wall on stolen land. And so that's the first time I'd seen it. You know, I've only seen it on Twitter and on Facebook images. And so I just want to say, seeing it written and inscribed on walls here is profound. And the talk that I want to give is very much situated in this context, right? In the context of no ban, no wall on stolen land. What does it mean to understand what is happening, not as new, but as an escalation of ongoing racial, political, economic violence against racialized communities? And that white supremacy is a process, right? Trump is a white supremacist, but white supremacy is a process. And that it is so important that we think about this as a process, because we know that Trump is not the first to deport people, is not the first to build a wall, is not the first to implement a registry, and most certainly was not the first settler colonial to arrive on these lands, right? And so what I want to talk about today is the importance of thinking through systemic forces and processes, particularly when it comes to border regimes. So my talk is focused on border regimes, but what I'm hoping we can do is look at the way it's connected to various forms of oppression and systemic violence.
And one of the reasons that I want to talk about systemic forces, there are many, but particularly as it's connected to this conference on transformable identities, is I also want to challenge the emphasis on identities that often takes place when we're talking about borders. And that is to say that so much of conversation and discourse, both on the left and the right, so across the political spectrum, when we're talking about immigration, focuses on the migrant, the refugee, the undocumented person, the so-called illegal. And on the right, of course, this identity is marked by, you know, what we could very, if I were to simplify it, we could call, you know, very negative stereotypes, right? So migrants, refugees, undocumented people as so-called terrorists or criminals, or, you know, the very oxymoronic, simultaneously lazy and job stealer, that makes no sense, right? So these kinds of negative stereotypes, but even on the left, particularly the liberal left, we see these same kinds of tendencies to fixate on who the migrant is, who the refugee is, who the undocumented person is, right? So the supposedly positive stereotypes, the taxpayer, the good contributor, the model minority, the assimilated, we're all American too, that kind of stuff. And I'll return to that. And I'll return to it during the talk, but I think ultimately, across the political spectrum, what we have is a problem, which is that we're focused on constructing the identity of who a migrant is, who a refugee is, who an undocumented person is or isn't, and in doing so, we no longer talk about, and we forget to talk about, I think the most foundational question, which is that how does someone come to become a migrant? How does someone come to become a refugee? How does someone to become undocumented? What are the forces, what are the systemic violences that inscribe these identities in the first place? We're not born any of those things. We're just certainly not born illegal. I don't believe any human being is illegal, right? And so the fact that these identities become inscribed across the political spectrum, I think, is a problem. And so what it does is, by focusing on the identity of the person, which isn't to say that identity is not important, I very much believe identity is important, but by focusing on our worthiness, on our identity as worthy, rather than our humanity as worthy, and rather than challenging the systemic forces, then discussions center around whether we are treated well or not, whether the state should accept more of us or not, whether we are desirable or not, whether we are deportable or not, right? So we lose sight of the interlocking modes of power and governmentality that I think is the most pressing issue that we need to be tackling all the time, and especially at this time. So it's in that context that I talk about border imperialism, and that's why I want to focus on talking about border imperialism as the framework from which we can move from questions of immigrants and migrants and refugees instead to questions of migration and displacement. And so I want to focus on centering and talking about those forces to turn the gaze away from who we are, rather than how we, and instead to talk about how we came to be, right? And turn the gaze back onto the state and onto other forms of violence that are ultimately responsible for these forms of oppression. And so to contextualize quickly, you know, what do I mean when I'm talking about migration and displacement? I also want to talk about this in a global context, because there is, I think, a danger by exceptionalizing what is happening, for example, at the, you know, in the United States or the American border, when in fact we know what is transpiring is a global crisis, right? What's happening in Europe, what's happening in Canada, what's happening across the global south is a global crisis. And so to contextualize, there are approximately 1 billion migrants and displaced people around the world today. 1 billion, right? And of course, every one of those folks has an individual story. I won't say too much about it, I can answer it later, but you know, I come from a family of migrants, of displaced people. I actually lived under a deportation order in Canada for approximately 9 years. I was detained and incarcerated in a detention center. My father's been deported from several countries, not one, but several countries, and so, you know, like many of you, or like many of the people we know, this is a common experience. And so we all have our own stories and our unique experiences within it, those of us who do. But also, within that, I think there are some generalizations that we can make, right? 1 billion people are not all the same. But I would say that there are some generalizations we can make that reveal the unequal relations, fundamentally, between rich and poor, between the global north and the global south, and between whiteness and its others, right? Those are some fundamental asymmetrical relationships that exist in the world. say some of the world's largest recent refugee populations come from Afghanistan, from Somalia, from South Sudan, and from Iraq. The other largest refugee population is, of course, Syrians, and I'm going to come back to this. And the world's largest kind of ongoing displaced community and populations is Palestinians, who are stateless refugees as a result of the ongoing illegal Israeli occupation of their homeland since 1948. And I want to be precise about that date, since 1948, not since 67, since 48. And so, you know, Syrian refugees are currently one of the largest demographics of refugees, with 5,000 Syrians fleeing every single day, with a total refugee population of 4.9 million at the end of 2015. Of a staggering total of 4.7 million displaced people in Iraq and Afghanistan, Iraq and Afghanistan also continue to be some of the largest world's refugee populations. And of course, we know in places like Iraq and Afghanistan, countries like the United States, governments of countries that I'm from, like Canada, have been complicit in Western military intervention, right? So we know that there has been ongoing military intervention in Iraq and Afghanistan. So I want to ask folks, out of, you know, the 4.9 million displaced people in Iraq and Afghanistan, can you guess approximately how many refugees the United States accepts every year from Afghanistan, on average?
10,000.
Approximately 500. So it fluctuates. It's in the few hundreds. It changes every few years. So, you know, this is abhorrent. It's abhorrent both because the numbers are a drop in the bucket, right? So we hear this border panic, border rush shit all the time, but 500 out of 4.9 million people is like less than 0.01%. And even more abhorrent, particularly because the United States is at least partly complicit in why people are forced to move from their lands. And of those accepted in places like the United States, they're more likely to be accepted if they're willing to accept the terms set forward by the United States government. So for example, if you serve the military by being an interpreter, if you're willing to give information against those considered counterinsurgents by the United States government, so basically if you're willing to serve the interests of empire, then you are granted refugee status, right? And yet we have this continued, one of the most prevalent logics when it came to the occupation of Afghanistan was, we were told it was a humanitarian intervention, right? We were told that it was actually to protect Afghan women, that this was under the rubric of saving Afghan women, which, as we know, is a very imperialist form of feminism that we see for a very long time, side note. But, you know, I think looking at the treatment by countries like the United States of displaced refugees is one of the key ways in which we can reject the logic of humanitarian intervention, right? Because if this was in fact a humanitarian intervention, then displaced refugee people would be one of the first communities to be welcomed. And that is not actually the case, right? So if this was a humanitarian intervention, then we'd actually see some humanitarianism. So displaced refugees not being welcome is one of the ways in which we can debunk that very obvious myth, for those whom it is not obvious. And so I think what it does suggest is that the occupation of Afghanistan and many other similar occupations are not actually humanitarian interventions, they're imperialist interventions. And they're a continuation of the white supremacist drive to civilize over there that has always been the drive for colonization, that is deeply connected to the ways in which settler colonization operates here in North America on Turtle Island, right? So the drive to colonize exists locally and globally. And as we know, the United States and Canada are founded on the logics of settler colonization and enslavement, so particularly against indigenous and black peoples. And so this intervention, again, often uses a very dangerous feminist logic, right? So returning to the idea that the intervention in Afghanistan was somehow to save Afghan women, this is what Gayatri Spivak has called, very bluntly, how this kind of logic, this imperialist feminist logic, is ultimately about saving brown women from brown men, right? And we can extend that to other racialized communities. And this kind of imperial feminism is based on the appropriation of women's rights in the service of empire, and has a very long history with the material consequences, right? So this does not only have material consequences
for women in Afghanistan who are bearing the brunt of military occupation. So women's organizations like RAWA, the Revolutionary Organization of Women in Afghanistan, one of the oldest feminist organizations in Afghanistan, has clearly spoken out about how intervention in Afghanistan has actually made it worse for women in Afghanistan. But it also has material consequences for Muslim women, particularly those who wear hijab or niqab, in the context of the West, right? So we have these really inflamed kinds of debates, which are not debates, they're hate speech and racial violence on Muslim women, right? Where we are told that women have no agency over how they choose to dress, where we are told where women become targets of gendered racial violence under the guise of so-called secular feminism, right? So the ways in which that kind of feminism puts women at greater risk. And so I think in the current context, returning to where we are today, I think this is precisely why the administrative ban is so violent. Not only because it excludes people from majority Muslim countries, but precisely because these are countries that the US has actively bombed and intervened in, right? So this logic of bombing and banning is the kind of connection we need to make. It is not enough to talk about the fact that people are banned, but that people are being bombed and then banned, right? That is the global connection we need to make. So we know that the countries that have been affected by the ban, Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen, have all been bombed in the recent years by the American administration, and Iran has been subject to US intervention for decades and has been subject to sanctions. And so this idea of banning, both bombing and banning, is what connects border regimes to this idea of imperialism, right? That these are connected systems of exclusions and violences that extend globally to locally and vice versa. And while militarization and persecution are typically understood as primary forces of displacement, I think we also have to make sure we're connecting forces of economic displacement, right? That political and economic systems are deeply connected. There was a report published last year by the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists who found that World Bank-funded projects, so the World Bank being, you know, the massive Bretton Woods institution that is basically responsible for neoliberal structuring across the global south, the World Bank-funded projects have displaced 3.4 million people in the last 5 years. And this is only World Bank-funded projects, right? That model is part of a number of global institutions. And so by funding privatization, land grabs, by backing companies and governments accused of rape, murder, and torture, millions of people have been forced to flee from their lands and homes as a result of this economic violence. And one of the most salient examples, of course, for the United States is NAFTA. And NAFTA has been back in the news a lot, of course, during both Bernie Sanders and Trump's election campaigns. And so I want to return to it for a minute. Even though, you know, NAFTA's all, and also there's now debate about renegotiating NAFTA and the impacts of it on the American economy. But I want to refocus conversations on NAFTA for a minute, because I think even in the Sanders campaign, I hope it'll become clear why, the kind of emphasis on saying that the reason that NAFTA was bad was because it was bad for the American economy, again, focuses on a form of American exceptionalism that refuses to look at the impacts of American economic and political violence on the global south. And this is dangerous not only in its exceptionalism that refuses to look outwards, but because it means that it is precisely the kind of logic that fosters the kind of populism that gives rise to Trump, right? So this kind of liberalism that is fixated with the American condition is precisely what leads to the kind of right-wing populism that we see. These are two flip sides of the same coin. One is more exaggerated, but they lead to the same kind of racialization and racial violence that we see. And so that's why I'm really troubled by also the Sanders campaign and its emphasis on the American economy at the expense of, not to say that is not an important conversation, but at the expense of looking at this in a global context. And so, you know, for folks who are everyone familiar with NAFTA, fairly? Right? So the two key provisions of NAFTA, of course, that had a huge impact on the Mexican economy was one, communally held land, so ejidos, which were communally held under the Mexican Constitution, were forcibly privatized and turned into private property. And this is actually one thing that's important to note. So turning communally held lands into private property is the essence of capitalism, right? To say that land is a commodity is something that we can own is the essence of capitalism and, of course, the essence of colonization. So one of the key challenges that exist across North America right now, as we know, is that indigenous people continue to hold land in common right? The idea that we don't own the land owns us, which is echoed across indigenous movements, across Turtle Island, is such a vital challenge, not only to colonization, but to capitalism itself, right? That we cannot own the land. And so NAFTA assured that what was happening was the privatization of communally held land and forcing people to live in smaller and smaller parcels of land. At the same time, the Mexican government was forced to eliminate subsidies to corn. And so this is another antithesis of the so-called free trade agreement, right? There's nothing free or fair about these fucking free trade agreements. They're completely subsidized by those who have power, right? There's nothing free or fair about them. So the American economy continues to get subsidized for shitty GMO corn that doesn't even naturally grow in the ecosystem. That's aggregate. I'm swearing too. Trigger warning. It's offensive because, you know, GMO agribusiness corn is getting subsidized that doesn't even grow naturally in these ecosystems, while literally hundreds and hundreds of strains of corn that are indigenous to places like Oaxaca, Guerrero, and Chiapas are annihilated because of the removal of subsidies coupled with the forced privatization of land. Right? So people are forcibly displaced from land, which is precisely why corn is such a key symbol of the Zapatista movement, for example, right? It's not a coincidence that food sovereignty and food security is such a key part of these resistance movements. And so as a result, the most conservative official estimates are that over 15 million Mexicans are forced into poverty, you know, 2 million over 10 years lost their lands and are forced to migrate to the southwest of the United States, itself illegally annexed territory, and are forced to look for work, right? And are forced to live in a state of migration. And this example of NAFTA is one of many, fundamentally this idea that we are here because you are there, right? Again, connecting the local to the global. We are here because you are there. So if really, you know, countries like the United States are so worried about their borders and border controls, then stop violating the borders of countries around the global south and indigenous people and low-income communities through forces like military occupation, through gentrification, right? All of these are connected systems of violating people's self-determination, yet at the same time they expect people to not move. And so, you know, climate change, I have a whole bunch of examples, but I'll run out of time, but I will just say that it's important to keep in mind that one of the largest, fastest growing refugee populations is climate refugees. And climate refugees have the proportion of people who are becoming displaced by climate change has increased by 60% over the past 20 years, by 60%, right? And, you know, this is immense. The kind of violence that this is causing is absolutely immense. This is the equivalent, so the number of people right now that are being displaced as a result of environmental disasters is one person every second, according to the International Organization of Migration. One person every second. And there are islands like Tuvalu that are expected to completely submerge into the ocean within 3 decades. Completely submerge. And so Tuvalu is one low-lying Pacific Island state that has actually said that what's happening to them is a form of terrorism. Right? If we were so concerned about acting against terrorism, we would care that there's an entire island country that is being submerged underwater. And the closest Western country to Tuvalu is Australia. One of the largest greenhouse gas emitters in the world. Can anyone guess how many climate refugees Australia has thus far welcomed into Australia?
Zero.
Zero. Zero. Because climate refugees are actually not even recognized as refugees. So not a single person from Tuvalu, even the one-fifth, an entire 20% of the island, is in a state of displacement. Not a single one of them has been able to find a home. Right? These are the kinds of things we have to talk about when we're talking about migrants and refugees. Right? We have to challenge the kinds of stereotypes we see in the news, not
just by saying, oh, well, immigrants are taxpayers. No, that is inadequate, not enough, and problematic at so many levels. We need to talk about, why are people here? What are our governments and corporations and policies doing that are forcing people to move from their lands? This is not an act of charity. We're not letting people in because it's an act of charity and we somehow think our liberal leading hearts are doing good. It's an act of responsibility, right? This is an act of responsibility because we're complicit and we're bound up in these systems of violence. And that's so imperative because I think a lot of that gets lost in conversations about migration. It emphasizes the benevolence rather than the responsibility, and it becomes these kind of conversations about charity. And so this is, it connects to the wall, right? So when we think about what's happening with the wall and the conversations about keeping people out and needing to challenge the jurisdiction and the authority of a colonial state to decide who can come in and who can come out despite its own violations of other people's borders, it's also important to come back to this connection to NAFTA. Because one of the things that I think happens a lot is we talk about why people are moving as separate from the border being securitized, right? And one of the facts that we don't often talk about is that when Operation Gatekeeper was put into place, so Operation Gatekeeper was put into place by the Democrats, right? By the previous Clinton administration. And that was the first major injection into securing the southern border. And it was implemented the very same year as NAFTA. The very same year as NAFTA. And this is so vital because it makes clear and lays bare that administrations that were involved in negotiating NAFTA knew that the impact of NAFTA would be that people would be forced to move. Right? That displacement was not an unintended consequence. They knew that neoliberalism would bring mass impoverishment and displacement. And they decided to fortify the wall the exact same year, right? And so those are also key connections to make. And similarly, when we're talking about the securing of the border, I think it is so vital that the language of border deaths be challenged. We talk about border deaths similarly in a very passive way. As if though people happen to die, right? People happen to die crossing the Arizona border. People happen to die crossing the Canary Islands. People happen to die crossing the Mediterranean. This is not a coincidence. 16,000 people happen to die crossing the Mediterranean over a span of a few years. 40% of migrants do not die en route to the Canary Islands. 40% die en route to the Canary Islands. These are not coincidences, right? And to me, challenging the inevitability of this death as a passive act is necessary. These are border killings. People are being killed. We've created a global system where it is impossible to move if you are black or brown or poor. If you have money and you're middle class and you're white and you have a Western passport, people go on vacations all the damn time. It is actually really increasingly easy for some people to move. And it is deadly for more and more people to move. That contradiction of free mobility for some and the rates at which some people are traveling versus the death that other people are experiencing is horrific and a direct result of white supremacist imperialist violence. And these are border killings, right? These are not coincidences. And this is so important to challenge because the more we talk about them as border deaths, as passive acts, to me it's very similar to rape culture, right? It's very similar to rape culture when the question is turned on women and trans folks and gender non-conforming and two-spirit folks, when we're told, well, why did you dress that way? Why were you out at night, right? The idea that somehow we had it coming. The same questions are raised about migrants. Well, why are they crossing if they know they're going to die? Why are they crossing when it's summer and it's 100 degrees Fahrenheit out, right? The victim blaming is a similar logic to the victim blaming of rape culture. And that has to be challenged just as vigorously as we challenge rape culture. And I want to give a quote from geographer Mary Pat Brady, who works at the southern border. And she says, the way that we talk about border deaths is a, quote, kind of passive capital punishment, where immigrants have been effectively blamed for their own deaths, right? And I think this is very accurate and very precise. And Isabel Garcia, who works in Tucson, describes what's happening at the borders as a war zone, because that is what it is, right? It's a war zone. Quote, we never thought that we'd be the business of helping to identify remains like in a war zone, and here we are, right? So I think it's important to also talk about what's happening as not just precarious displacement or people having to move, but people are dying in the process of moving and are being killed in the process of moving. And of course, a lot of this is fundamentally about racism, right? It's impossible to talk about displacement, migration, and border imperialism without talking about racism. And you know, this is true about the United States. It's especially true in Canada, where we really, really think we live in a post-racial world. Everywhere I go, people are like, well, isn't Canada better? It's like a multicultural haven. And you're like, and so I think, you know, there's many ways, right? Systemic racism and white supremacy exists in every single institution. It's pervasive. I don't want to belabor that point, because I feel like that's something that folks can grasp and understand, at least at a basic level. But I think particularly when it comes to immigration, one of the most, I actually want to boil it down to a simpler question, which is a seemingly innocuous question, and a lot of people here are probably familiar with it, but it's the question of where are you from? Right? The question of where are you from? So how many people here get that question? Where are you from? Well, hopefully everyone gets it, maybe to some degree, right? And then you're asked, no, where are you really, really from? Like, I'm from Corvallis. No, where are you really, really from? I'm really, really from Corvallis. I mean, you know, like that consistent line of questioning that implies that somehow, particularly certain racialized communities are actually not from here, right? So you're living in this kind of hyphenated identity. And this works in a lot of different ways, right? So one is that it, of course, completely displaces indigenous people, right? So the assumption that if a white person answers, I'm from Corvallis, then they won't get another line of questioning. Well, actually, where are your ancestors from, right? Which colonizing part of Europe are your ancestors from? that line of questioning isn't repeated, right? So if I'm going to get asked, where am I really, really from, and I have to answer that, well, then so should white people, right? Standards, that's the problem, and that whiteness is somehow seen as natural to Turtle Island, when in fact it's not, right? Whiteness is not natural to Turtle Island, and so it displaces indigenous people, right? It also naturalizes colonization as some kind of benevolent act that took place on these lands, rather than the violence that it did bring, right? And also completely erases the processes of enslavement, right? So these questions of where are you from, even though they seem harmless, unless we actually interrogate them fully, are loaded with racial violence. And that extends then, you know, and these are just the interpersonal, right? These are just one of many interpersonal ways that then extends into the institutional. So particularly for immigrants and refugees, the signifier of being a constantly, eternally hyphenated citizen, right? The Arab American, for example, the Muslim American, where you're never really quite American enough, regardless of how long you've actually lived on these lands, right? The idea of never belonging quite fully. And this is, you know, connected to the next point that I want to make about border imperialism, which is to say that it's by talking about racism, by talking about these forces of oppression, that we start to see that this is precisely why the identity of immigrant and refugee is loaded. Because that has nothing to do with who we are as individuals. It has everything to do with these processes of racialization and criminalization. Right? Because even if you're no longer an immigrant, even if you happen to legally be carrying a passport for whatever that's worth, right? You're still seen. You're still seen as not belonging. And that's connected to processes of criminalization. So in this is probably not the case for the United States, or maybe it is for parts of the United States, and I'd love to be challenged on that. But in British Columbia, the province that I live in, until recently, actually I'm going to ask you to guess. Can you guess what the most common myth was of who was undocumented in the province? So if someone was to say, la la la, all the illegals, who would they be thinking about? Mexicans, Asians. Irish. All these people, right? I mean, pretty similar to the United States, right? Various, depending on where people were, various kind of racialized stereotypes. Latin, you know, Central and South American, Asian,
you know, various kind of brown racialization. But until recently, the statistically largest proportion of people who were documented in British Columbia, I get really excited telling people this, white fucking Australians. Right? Nothing. I mean, I don't mean to say white fucking, like, whatever, Australian. But like, the ways in which that operates, right? Like, no one would have guessed that ever, that it was predominantly white Australians. And the ways that this happens is because, you know, either Australians come on a tourist visa and decide that they're going to work, which is technically illegal, or they come on a work visa and their work visa expires, so technically illegal, right? And a lot of them are working in the ski resort industries. If anyone ever travels up to places like Whistler and, you know, Sun Peaks, all these kinds of resort industries, you'll see that. But of course, as you can imagine, the treatment of white Australians in the media is with an is first of all generally ignored, right? But if it ever was to be depicted, it's with a lot of sympathy, like, oh, this poor person is just trying to work in Canada and we're making their life hell. Look at this bureaucracy they have to go through. Why does immigration treat them so badly? Just stamp their visa, right? Like, it's with an immense amount of sympathy for the struggle that they're going through, right? It seems profoundly unfair that they're dealing with this awful bureaucracy. But of course, that is not the same treatment that people of color get, right? Racialized black and brown people who are facing deportation do not get that same kind of empathy, compassion, media construction, overall kind of attitude, right? So we see that even in talking about so-called illegality, it's racialized. It has nothing to do with your actual legal, your legal status in the country.
It has to do with how your racialization is read. I think my mic's off.
And so, you know, that's connected, of course, to criminalization in a number of ways. So the ways in which the illegal is constructed when it comes to non-status and undocumented people is, of course, the very same way criminalization operates in a number of different ways, right? So the prison industrial complex, the criminal injustice system are fundamentally built on racialized, patriarchal, trans-misogynist, anti-poor ideas of who so-called criminals are, right? That is the basis of racial profiling in the criminal injustice system. We know that communities of color, particularly black communities and black trans women and black women, are not disproportionately targeted, incarcerated because people are committing so-called criminal acts. It's because this is a system that disproportionately targets those people and those bodies and those communities, right? And so it's that same idea that these kinds of legal systems are given the authority, despite the fact that they're built, and they're given a veneer treatment when in fact they're built on fundamental social hierarchies, right? And immigration is the same way. It has nothing to do with your legal status and entirely everything to do with how you are perceived and constructed and built in the world, right? So it has nothing to do with actual legalities, which is precisely the problem with, I think, a lot of the logic of the immigrant rights discourse, right? So when we emphasize our so-called legality, when we emphasize our so-called contributions, that is not going to save us because that is not how the system views us. That is not what the system cares about, right? So it's actually necessary to challenge white supremacy, anti-blackness, settler colonialism, anti-capitalism, rather than proving that we are able to contribute to those systems, right? And so the connection to capital is the last thing that I want to talk about. And this is so vital because, of course, when we're talking about immigration, there's often at least some lens around racial justice, sometimes less so around economic justice. And capitalism is so foundational to the process of immigration, right? When we look at the Bracero program and the fact that it continues, that is ultimately about ensuring that immigrants are providing a stream of cheap labor, right? And migrants, particularly immigration, has always been viewed as the pool of people who can provide cheap, disposable labor, right? And so immigrants have always been constructed in this commodified way. And so that's another reason it becomes so important to push back against the logic of worthiness, because that is exactly what the system wants from us. And in Canada, one of the reasons that I bring up Canada, particularly when it comes to the connection to capital, and this is so important for American folks to understand, is that when people say, well, isn't Canada so much better? You don't really have an undocumented community or population. And it's true. We don't have proportionately even the same number of non-status people. But that's not because people are living with permanent legal status. It's because Canada has perfected the temporary foreign worker program. And Canada is currently the model, the world's model, for managed migration that the United States actually wants to copy. And not for good reasons, right? It's because it's figured out that Canada has figured out how to perfectly manage immigration streams. And so in short, what this is it's basically the Bracero program. Canada allows people to come in under temporary foreign worker visas, and when people's labor is no longer needed, you're basically deported out of the country. You're not allowed to bring your families. You work an average of, and legally, right? This isn't even undocumented, under the table. This is legally a program that allows employers to have you work 16 hours a day. That legally allows you to not have a minimum wage. That legally allows you not to unionize, right? That legally, in some cases, forces you to live in the home of your employer. Like, who wants to live in the home of their employer?
Ever.
Let alone as someone who's vulnerable. So you're having your identification confiscated. For women who come to work as caregivers and domestic workers in British Columbia, over 70% report assault and sexual violence and rape. Right? So this isn't a situation of a few bad employers. This is a state-sanctioned program that legalizes violence. Right? It sanctions and wants this form of violence to keep people precarious. And this is the model that the United States wants to import. Right? The United States has had it and continues to have it under the guest worker program, but wants to import it as the one that Canada has perfected. And this guest worker program, temporary foreign worker program, is so vital to understanding the contradiction of the North American political economy, I would argue, right? Which is that on the one hand, you're dealing with this surge, always existing, but escalating surge in right-wing white supremacist violence, right? Which is like, we do not want black and brown bodies, particularly those who are non-migrant, right? So there's a particular kind of anti-immigrant response that we don't want these bodies, right? The threat of coloring America, the threat of coloring Canada, right? The threat of 2050, all of the census numbers showing that we're a demographic majority, but as if though we're not diverse people, right? So there's that threat. There's the threat of coloring what is presumed to be the white man's land, right? Again, displacing indigenous folks from their own lands. But at the same time, there's the contradiction where the state needs the cheap labor for the political economy, particularly for the service sector. Right, the farms, every single sector that's reliant on cheap labor. So the guest worker programs resolve this contradiction, which is like, sure, we will take your cheap labor, we will force you to be cheap laborers, but we will ensure that you are then deportable. Because you will be legally in a deportable stream. You will not be living underground, and that's the carrot, right? That you will be able to return another year, another season. Right? So you're in the state, and you're in the nation state, but you are never of the nation state. And in Canada, there are farm workers that have been in this program for 3 or 4 generations. Grandfather, father, and son. Without the possibility of bringing their families, without ever getting status, and every season being deported back, predominantly from the Caribbean and South and Central America, right? So predominantly black and brown agricultural workers. And so this is why, you know, coming back to NAFTA and folks even like Sanders, this is why rejecting the logic of the American worker or the American economy as central to how we build political movements is so vital, right? Because it is precisely the idea that immigrants are stealing our jobs that allows for the wage floor to then be lowered even further for immigrant workers. It is precisely what then allows a further backlash, right, against immigrant people and people of color generally. So that is why it is so important that instead of saying, you know, we need to protect the American economy and we need to protect American workers first, that we need to talk about, well, what does an international movement look like? What does it mean to say, actually, no one should be forced from their land and we need to stop being responsible for people being forced off their land? And we need to ensure anyone who wants to move can do so with full rights. Right? Full rights of residency, full labor rights, full rights to reunification with their families, and rights to residency. Status, right? Status for all. And so this isn't just about an immigrant rights movement. This is something that folks like working class labor movement folks also need to understand. That unless we have an internationalist movement that looks at how the wage floor is being lowered for everybody, ultimately migrants, particularly those who are non-status, who are going to bear the brunt of this violence. And so, to conclude on, so, okay, what the fuck next, right? Like, everything's wrong. The world is, like, racist and oppressive. I already knew that. And so, you know, what am I hoping that this kind of talk illuminates? So, the first is that, I think I've reiterated a few times, which is that immigrants and refugees don't just happen to be, right? We're not a product of coincidence. We're manufactured through systems of colonization and capitalism. And also that someone who is a migrant is actually often constantly migrating, right? So that even when you might get legal status, you're constantly in a state of figuring out how you're able to belong in a space that is so informed by white supremacy. And also that migration often is a very violent, precarious situation for many people, right? Outright exclusion and murder through heavily patrolled borders. And so I think what this builds on is the fact that any immigrant rights movement needs to perceive itself through a lens of anti-colonial, anti-capitalist, anti-black, and not anti-black, a lens that encapsulates what it means to be fighting against border imperialism from a lens that understands the local to the global and that understands the connections between different movements, right? And that we're also fighting on stolen indigenous lands. And so what is the alternative to a lot of the immigrant rights movements that are more mainstream? So the first, I think, is that any migrant justice movement needs to articulate that all human beings are inherently worthy and valuable, right? So the idea that no human being is illegal is necessary. Again, because so much of migration is continuously linked to the commodification of migrants or our desirability or our value, I think repeating and internalizing the idea that no human being is illegal is so important. Again, rather than articulations of we are all American or, you know, the model minority tax-paying migrants are the ones you want to support, right? So I think the articulation of no human being is illegal is one of the most important iterations in a movement. And instead of talking about immigrants being hard workers or good enough, and I understand the place that comes from, like I do as someone who's lived that, but I think it is so important we de-link ourselves and our bodies and our humanities from labor in the wage economy, right? Which isn't to say that we aren't forced to labor in the wage economy, but that our humanity is not dependent on the wage economy. Because that what does that mean for migrants who are not laboring in the same ways, right? What does it mean for people who are disabled and or differently abled, for single mothers, for elders, for seniors, for people who are not educated in the formal education system, for folks who are black, who are not English speaking, for people who may have a criminal record? All of the markers of undesirability that the state already imposes on so many of us, what does it mean if migrant justice movements and immigrant rights movements start reproducing those same kinds of exclusions and those same ideas of desirability, right? That is not something that we want. And I think here it's particularly important to look at the impact of these kinds of good immigrant discourses on black immigrants. So the Black Alliance for Just Immigration notes that although black immigrants comprise 5% of the undocumented population in the United States and 7.2% of the total non-citizen population, they make up a striking 10 to 20% of all immigrants in removal proceedings, right? So looking again at the disproportionate impact of black immigrants who are being forcibly removed and deported, right? So again, within our discourses, who is centered, who is not, who is lifted up, who is not. And here I want to recall the words of Chicana writer Gloria Anzaldúa, who says that borders and walls that are supposed to keep undesirables out are entrenched habits and patterns of behavior. And so I think of this call of hers as implicating not only the physical landscapes of borders, but also the social landscape of exclusion and domination within our own movements. And so, you know, I think when it comes to turning back to identities, so what kinds of identities can help us transform through struggle, right? So if we think, and extending on this idea of no human being is illegal, what would it mean to center and support migrants who are the least so-called desirable by the state and center those voices in the movement, right? So instead of our movement lifting up the most kind of assimilated, and by saying assimilated, I'm not judging anyone in their struggle, but to say, but rather than placing up or lifting up ones that we think the state will want to see, right, as the face of the immigrant rights community? What would it mean to instead lift up those whom the state has discarded as those whom we center within our movements, right? What does it mean to actively lift up those whom the state wants us to leave behind? And by way of example of that, I'll give an example of a movement and a moment that we were involved in No One Is Legal. And this was in like 2009 or something. And so I'll make this quick, but it's a lovely story. And so there was a Dalit Punjabi refugee claimant who was paralyzed. And so Dalit folks, for folks who don't know, are folks that are considered so-called untouchable in the caste system, right? And so folks who have the least privilege in the context of Brahminical communities in South Asia. And so, and a lot of historical connection between Dalit and Black communities. And so a Dalit Punjabi who was paralyzed from the waist down, so completely bedridden is how he described himself, unable to speak English. And he's a refugee claimant who was facing deportation in 2008, 2009 in Vancouver. And so we were involved in supporting him and building community around him. And literally every single organization that we turned to for support, you know, we got the classic answer, right? Which is like, no, we're not going to support him. Why are you supporting him? There's no way he's going to get status. There's no way he's going to give the community a bad name, right? So all of those kinds of internalized and oppressive logics for why someone like him shouldn't be supported. And so we worked on a campaign for two years to slowly build support, to talk about these ideas, right, of no one left behind, of needing to center people who are the least likely to get support. And there's a whole lot of story to this. But I'll say that on December 10th of 2009, over 2,000 people, non-English speaking, predominantly Punjabi seniors, like literally 80, 90-year-old and older, showed up to the Vancouver International Airport and physically blocked his deportation. And the entire international airport was shut down for the entire day. And he was not able to be deported. And at that time, you know, this predated the, and it was interesting because the folks who were working on the DocuBus deportations had gotten in touch with us because they said this was one of their inspirations at the time. But this was the first time in North American history, in recent American history at that time, where deportation had been blocked, right, through direct action. And direct action by people who are presumed to be model minorities, who people think will not stand up for other people. But elders in particular saw themselves reflected in his story, right? Saw themselves also similarly as cast as not contributing, as people who were not in the wage economy. And his deportation was stopped. And that was a vital lesson, right? That even when something is perceived as not winnable, that cannot determine the ethics of how we mobilize. Whether a campaign is winnable in the eyes of the state is not how we can or should organize. We organize on the basics of our own ethics, right? On the basis that people have a right to life, people have a right to self-determination, and every single person has a right to dignity, and every single person deserves support, right? The state is not gonna believe in that, but we have to believe in that, right? If we lose sight of that and we start adopting their logic is when we start losing our movements, right? And so the idea of winnability cannot be our gauge, which isn't to say we should be on a like hamster wheel that never wins. But it is to say that we have to care about our people. And we have to lift up our people and we have to protect our people. And so in terms of what that means in terms of moving forward, I think it's not just a political practice, right? It's an ethical orientation of how we organize within our communities. Because once we start to take that seriously, it means that everything moves around that, right? Everything gets centered around that. And so to conclude, I want to leave you with the words of Eduardo Galeano, the late great poet, and Eduardo Galeano said, "The world was born yearning to be a home for everyone." Right? The world was born yearning to be a home for everyone. And so I leave you with that, and for us to think about what an expansive idea of home means, right? What does it mean to be home on our land? What does it mean to be able to be home in our bodies, in our communities, to be able to have a home? To be able to have homes on Turtle Island and Palestine, to have our gender identities be valued and recognized, to be able to be at home with one another, right? So where we can create intimacy and vulnerability with one another and to be valued, right? Where every single person has worth and is not disposable. And so again, to invoke Eduardo Galeano, the world was born yearning to be a home for everyone. Thank you.